Honourable presiding member, we have heard many emotional and sentimental outbursts in this house ever since this serious, dastardly suicide attack took place. And today we are discussing under the regulations that are being debated in this house, once again, the plight of this country's economy. It is not a secret that one of the targets of those terrorists was, terrorists as well as their handlers, was to create a serious impact on the revival of our country's economy. So that was evident from the manner in which several hotels were made targets of these terrorists. In that background, I must congratulate the Minister, the State Minister of Finance, and the Ministry for having formulated a relief scheme for the tourism industry in particular, so that they can bounce back to their normalcy. However, we must also bear in fact that while we have given relief to those involved directly in the tourism industry to a certain extent, there are a variety of other enterprises and businesses that has backward linkages with the tourism sector. You can name a number of them. Particularly, restaurants are there. There are gem and jewelry business people, arts and crafts people, entertainment people. There are normal taxi drivers, auto drivers. Variety of such people are also affected. So we may have to look at how we can bring all those affected people with backward linkages to the tourism industry as well to enjoy some relief package so that they can get over their livelihood issues that they are compelled to face because of this unfortunate incident. Together with that, we must also remember that there are certain other sectors of the economy that are not too seriously affected. We have had a bumper harvest, and the agriculture sector is not bound to be affected unnecessarily unless we have, now with the yala season, if we can have a better harvest, we could use that to mitigate this to a certain extent. Similarly, the manufacturing sector, the industry sector, though it is somewhat affected, is not as seriously affected as the tourism sector. Therefore, the manufacturers and the industrialists of this country must redouble their efforts to increase the export volume so that we can, to a certain extent, try and bridge the gap that would definitely be bringing a serious impact on the economy. So with that in mind, this is also pertinent for us to note that every time we impose emergency regulations and a state of emergency in the country, that also, to a certain extent, blunts the ability of our law enforcement mechanism to properly investigate matters because they resort to very short-term summary measures that are provided without proper legal scrutiny. So this also should be borne in mind. Now we see that all over the country panic buttons are pushed. People are living in tension. It is time for us now to de-escalate this tension and get back to normalcy. In this regard, it is important for us to also remember there is a responsibility cast on the media in this country. Now, if you look at the electronic media today, they are sensationalizing news. They are looking for news that could bring further fear and harm to the country. So this also must be handled properly. To a certain extent, warnings have been given. I hope our media fraternity would be a little more considerate about the need to de-escalate the tension in the country, not to sensationalize issues. I see all over search operations are conducted. When search operations are conducted, in certain areas, we see people, those who are going for the search operations are going with video cameras and cameras on tow. This must be avoided. What is important is for us to unearth the truth. Towards that, much has been done. Maybe a little more needs to be done. But in the meantime, we need not unnecessarily sensationalize every trivial incident. What is happening today is this is adding to the fear psychosis in the country. As a result, today schools are empty, children are not being sent to schools by their parents, workplaces are also facing high absenteeism. Therefore, the entire economy is going to suffer because of a unnecessary heightened state of security alert. Now, it is time for us to de-escalate things. Towards de-escalation, the security forces also have to contribute by trying to be much more balanced in their approach, while not compromising on the need to maintain security in the country. We also need to be a little more considerate in giving publicity to every trivial incident that may happen when we go on a search operation to a particular area. Now, much has been spoken about the knives and swords and all kinds of cutting equipment that have been found in search operations. I can't see what is so surprising about this. If you find, now the in particular, localities where Muslim communities reside have been undergoing a combing operation with the focus on unearthing any offensive material that may be found. True enough, whatever that have been found has to be investigated properly and action should be taken. But what is happening today is that exposure to some of these issues is creating an impression as if this country's Muslim community has been waiting to cut and chop the entire country's population. The fact is far from that. If you really go and do the search operations in other parts of the country where other communities live, you will find equal number of similar items everywhere. So this is not to be blown out of proportion and creating an unnecessary fear psychosis. And we must also remember, in any society, there will be criminal elements. There will be some people who will be storing items which is for their self-defense purposes. This normally happens in a country where we have faced violence all the time. So this should not be interpreted to mean that everybody was waiting to engage in terrorist activity in the country. This is very unfortunate. It is also necessary for security forces to see that they should not unnecessarily abuse the Prevention of Terrorism Act. I am sure they have, in many places, they have acted with a lot of responsibility and have avoided putting everybody into one bundle and putting everybody under the PTA. Instead of that, normal laws should be resorted to where it is appropriate. And when the suspicion is not too serious, we could always resort to the normal law. What is happening in law enforcement is, whenever there is a long period of emergency, the security forces and the law enforcement authorities also get acclimatized to a situation where they even forget what is how to file cases during the times of normalcy. They always have been used to dispensing with the necessary procedures that has to be adopted in a proper investigation, and that the entire ability to investigate also gets blunted in the process. So therefore, emergency always doesn't help a situation. It is an extraordinary power that is vested in the forces to meet an extraordinary situation. That is why the Public Security Ordinance was promulgated. That Public Security Ordinance is not brought into force at every whim and fancy of the political authorities. Only when there is a situation where the country faces serious security risk that we promulgate, we bring in emergency regulations. Those must be used proportionately and not unnecessarily so that they bundle everybody together. So this must be brought to light, particularly in view of what is happening today all over the country. The Muslim community as a whole has begun to have a serious introspection about our own conduct and where this whole, you know, we are all astounded and are in shock as to how such a murderous, heinous cult could have ever existed among us, and using religion for such a terrible crime is a matter of shame for all of us. Therefore, it is time for us to look at these issues with serious introspection and try and prevent such a tendency to develop. In the meantime, it is also up to the security forces and the police to see that they will not be lumping everybody together. There are a vast number of innocent people who have had to face serious social stigma by arrests that are taking place. Fair enough, if you have found something offensive, arrest them, inquire them, and then if it is found to be a matter of having something which, for which they don't offer proper explanation, but have proper investigation, but then file the B report so that they would be able to get bail and that be released without having to be locked up for too long. Because that's very important for us, because that should not create a fertile ground for radicalization. It is very important for us to bear in mind. Overreaction to an issue also is creating an unnecessary panic in the country. This has to be avoided. Mr. Presiding Member, whenever there has been emergency, there have been abuses. Abuse takes place when there is excessive power vested in law enforcement authorities. In this situation, it is necessary for us to empower our security forces and the police to have these extensive powers. But while we give them the extensive powers, they must be mindful to use that power sparingly and to the extent necessary, and not to disproportionately use that power to harass the people. And that is what I thought I must highlight, because that also impinges on law and order in the country. Law and order is necessary for us to create normalcy in the country. Normalcy will finally result in bringing back the economy to its original position. In that regard, these matters must be very carefully borne in mind, and I must thank the army commander in particular, having highlighted the fact that their security operations and their search operations are being conducted in an effective and efficient manner, and people can get back to normalcy, and there is no threat of bombs going off anymore. The army commander himself has very, very diligently highlighted this fact, but despite him saying that, people are still unable to come back to normalcy, and it is high time that the political authorities also take charge of the situation and try and quickly de-escalate this matter. As far as I'm concerned, the Higher Education Ministry has notified all the vice chancellors of the universities today to begin a process of opening universities from 13th onwards. We have told them from Monday onwards to they are having the discretion, after having satisfied themselves with a thorough search of the entire university premises. You know, Mr. Presiding Member, our universities are in very vast properties, extensive areas. We have got to search every nook and corner of the entire number, 15 national universities are there. So every higher educational institute, if they are to be checked, it's going to take a little time. But that has been happening for the last 2 weeks, and we would rather wish that by next week, the process of reopening universities, at least in sections, entire university, if there are certain difficulties, we have asked them to consider faculty by faculty to start their academic courses. Therefore, it is important for us to somehow get back to normalcy and not feed into the unnecessary panic that has been set in. It is important. That is the only way in which we can recover and teach a lesson to that hidden hand which caused this heinous crime in this country that we will never succumb to the designs of these mad terrorists who targeted our nation. It's unfortunate that that small cult was from within our community, and it is I'm coming from a press conference where the religious leaders of the Muslim community, the civil society leaders, and us political leaders all together addressed the media and gave the same message to the entire nation, that the community has come forward to have a very serious introspection about all matters concerning our community, where unnecessary suspicions have been roused among our brother communities in the country. And we are ready to be as open for a dialogue on every issue, so that these suspicions will also be put to rest and we'll be able to live as one nation. And this motherland has to be saved from this hidden hand which has decided to destabilize us. And this has happened every now and then, and this time, thankfully...
Honorable Minister, you have 2 more minutes.
Yeah. Thankfully, we have come to a situation where it is a... if not for the political leadership quarreling among ourselves, even in this house, I see the opposition and the government is still finger-pointing at each other and are not coming together. At times of national crisis, it is incumbent on all of us to unite and to have a unified approach towards calamity such as this. Unfortunately, that is absent when you look at the debates during the past few days. We need to realize the fact that it is time that we all unite and get back to normalcy as fast as possible. And that is the only way in which we can teach a lesson to those who had been bent on plunging our country back to the days of darkness. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.